In the afternoon, our style will be, format will be different than the morning. As you can see, we have four business panelists sitting in the front. So it will be more interactive. There will be no formal presentation on the screen, so you don't have to, you know, look up constantly. Before we start, I want also let you know that we have a hashtag for this event. I forgot to mention it this morning. It's doing biz, B-I-Z, in Africa. So those of you who have a Twitter account or know how to tweet, you can, you know, let the world know that you are here attending this wonderful event. I personally don't use tweets, so I don't know what that entails, but you know, we have that hashtag created, so might as well use it. So let me introduce to you our moderator facilitator of the afternoon session, Mr. Richard Paullin. He's the director of Illinois
District. I'm the chairman of the Illinois District Export Council.
Okay.
And the executive director of the International Trade Association of Greater Chicago.
So he will be moderating our business panel, and we have four distinctive guests here, and their bios are all included in the brochure. So you know, each of them have a very impressive background and experience in Africa, among other things. So without further ado, I'm just going to turn the podium to Mr. Paullin.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you all for coming for dessert. This is the best part of the day. The concept for the panel this afternoon is to talk about best practices and lessons learned from actually doing business in Africa. Many years ago, we used to hold a program that we called Halloween in August, and it was always, here are all the things we did wrong in these markets. Hopefully, this will be more about what these distinguished panelists did right. I'll introduce them, starting left to right, and then maybe if we could even talk in that order, that would be fine. The concept, though, is for each of the panelists to give you a very brief background on their business and how exporting fits into their business, why they're exporting or working in Africa, how they got started, how they found their first customers in Africa, how they figured out, you know, which customers to look for, what sales channels they were looking for. To talk briefly about any unusual challenges in Africa compared with other global markets. And these might be financing, risk management, shipping, transportation, dispute resolution, there may be things, who knows. And finally, to talk briefly about what they see as the future prospects for growth in Africa. If there are new markets, if there are maturing markets where they see great opportunity, that's what we hope they will talk about kind of briefly. From left to right, we have Mr. Eugene Bostoe, the president of Ability Engineering Technology. Next to him, we have Sophia Leaguedi, the president of Ameroc Export. Cheryle Jackson, the vice president of Government Affairs and Corporate Development for AAR Corp. And last but not least, Kevin Sofen, the business development manager for W.S. Darley and Company. So, Eugene, I'd like to start with you.
Yeah. My name's Eugene Bostoe. I'm the president and owner of a company here in South Holland, Ability Engineering Technology, founded in the late 40s. I bought the business mid-2010, 2009. We are a manufacturing engineering design company. Our customer base includes the federal government. We build a lot of high-end products for NASA, NIST, Department of Energy. We build equipment for academic institutions, and we build equipment used by industrial companies. I think for the purpose of what we do, and for this organization, I'll probably talk more about the types of equipment we design and build primarily for process for industrial companies, which is we build tanks, pressure vessels, we build heat exchangers, we build piping systems. So where would you use a piping system? For example, in a brewery or in a petrochemical facility where you're moving a product from one end to the other, you need pipes, you need valves, control systems. Those are the types of things we build. Depending on where we do business, we do probably about 75% of our business is still here in North America and the US, but about 25% or so is outside the US, primarily in Asia and a little bit in Africa. When we do business in Africa, we typically sell some of our higher-end products for cryogenics. Cryogenics is technology where you cool a product to a very, very low temperature. So we do work in industrial gas. We do work with moving gases and fluids, etc. In Africa, our focus is more products used for process applications. So pressure vessels, piping systems, piping skids, doing some basic fabrication work, making parts for, let's say, a turbine, or making parts for a person who just needs precision machined equipment and parts. That's kind of what we try and focus on in Africa. And also working with clients to source equipment that they can't easily get within those countries, especially instrumentation and controls type products that are not very easy to get. And working with some of them as they look at trying to upgrade their current facilities. Let's say an oil refining facility wants to buy new equipment to upgrade. We have a controls group here that can help them get the right types of instrumentation to be able to upgrade their facility. So, in a nutshell, a little bit of everything.
Sophia?
Hi, everybody. My name is Sophia Leaguedi, the president and founder of Ameroc Export. As a trade company building bridges between US manufacturers and the buyers in the international market. We are worldwide exclusive distributor of Medco industrial tires made in USA. And we are presenting them worldwide. And also we are exclusive distributor of Warco automotive lubricants in Africa and Middle East. That's what we're doing.
So.
Good afternoon. My name is Cheryle Jackson, and I work for AAR Corp. AAR is a global aviation services company. It's about a $2 billion company with about between 5,500 and 6,000 employees worldwide, mostly here. What we do is two things, transportation services. So we helicopter and short stall aircraft for humanitarian, military, actions around the country, support the Department of Defense and State Department, and also some other countries outside the US and their Air Force efforts. So that's transportation. The lion's share of what we do is aviation services. So we provide heavy maintenance support of aircraft, both commercial and government. So any plane that you step onto, we've done the heavy C checks on that aircraft. As a part of that, we do supply chain, aviation supply chain as well. So we work with commercial and government airlines around the world and governments on logistics and supply chain.
Hello, my name is Kevin Sofen from W.S. Darley & Company. Darley is a 108-year-old family-owned company based here in Chicago, Itasca. We have manufacturing plants in Chippewa Falls, Wisconsin, Iowa, and Colorado. And we manufacture fire pumps, fire trucks, and water purification equipment. And we've been exporting ever since after the World War II, since 1940. And about over 50% of the products we manufacture are exported. We do business in over 100 countries every year. And we're expanding into new product solutions. In particular, I focus on stationary fire suppression systems and portable water treatment systems. And we've done some work with Exxon. In particular, we were highlighted earlier. We recently sold 32 fire trucks into the state of Nigeria, Lagos.
Yeah. Okay, so the question now is, how did you get started selling in Africa? Anybody?
For us, it was through a trade mission trip, and it was right here. We came, married, invited, you know, the usual invitation, and we finally decided, you know, let's go check it out. And I think Sam Intoom was one of the speakers, and one of the countries that we're going to on that trip was they were going to go to Ghana and then go to Ethiopia. And I'm originally from Ghana, so that piqued my interest. I hadn't been in a while, and I thought, let's go and see what's going on the continent and see whether there were opportunities for us to do business. So as a result of that trip and the fact that they had, I'm trying to think of the word, where they invite companies to come and meet with you and talk to you, the Chamber of Commerce in those countries got companies that they thought would fit. We met, and out of those discussions, you know, met some other people, and here we go.
Eugene, was this a U.S. Department of Commerce trade?
U.S. Department of
Commerce.
No, it was a state, Illinois.
Okay.
So staff grants, step grant. So for those of you who are looking at maybe doing work in Africa or some other places, if you can take advantage of a step grant, at least it covers some of the costs associated with making that initial trip. Because I guarantee you, if we hadn't had a chance to have some of those costs covered, probably wouldn't have made that trip.
Okay. Sophia, same?
Briefly background. Before I came to America, I was working Minister of the Finance in Morocco. I'm originally from Morocco. And when I immigrated to America, we started to franchise mobile auto body in Los Angeles area. In 2006, I got to know about free trade agreement between US and Morocco. And that was the starting point, knowing fully that it will be a successful field for me. I started importing from Morocco, but after deep thought, I believe that the potential of success will be greater in export instead of importing from Morocco, and that's how it started.
Okay, and how did the free trade agreement help you?
Well, free trade agreements, when I got into export business, I was trying, it took a time to figure out how I can start and to expand my export business. It was tough in the beginning. It was not until I met with Mary Ma. I still really appreciate all your help they give to the people who want to start or to expand their business in export field. So we get to know about this, the product, what they are providing and, with the U.S. Department of Commerce. Trade missions, that's the starting point for any exporters. It is great, a great approach. I last 12 months, I did six trade missions. Went to Morocco, Egypt, Jordan, Guatemala, Salvador, Costa Rica. The last one was Israel. I came back with a purchase order. That was really great. How do you help? It is a really great help. Before we go to trade mission, they analyze our products. If we are qualified, then they connect us with U.S. Department of Commerce. Many thanks to Raj, Dan, and Monica. They connect us with the U.S. Embassy in the market we are targeting.
That's the gold key, the gold keys that we're talking about earlier.
Yes, the gold key. Well, it has a meaning when they said gold key. It is a real gold key. So they facilitate the connection with the potential client, B2B meeting. Before we get there, we have a list prepared. Potential clients, potential partners, considered end users or distributors for our product. Amazingly, all of them, they are qualified. You know, I don't know who to pick to be our distributor, which is a really great approach. They open the doors widely for us to promote our product in the market we are targeting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Cheryle, I expect your experience is going to be different.
It's a little different. So AAR is a 60-year-old company, and we're based in Northwest Chicago. We had been doing business, the company, particularly with South Africa Airways, you know, pre-post-apartheid, South Africa Airways was the, you know, largest airlines in the country, but more importantly, their technical operation called South African Airlines Technical really dominated Africa, and they had all the skills and resources, and they supplied and maintained aircraft all across the continent. Post-apartheid, they lost a lot of that that capacity. And they outsourced, the skill sets were lost, and they outsourced to Europe and Asia all of their maintenance. So with that, we sort of lost our footing in SAAT, we call it SAAT, South Africa, but all of Africa. So we're sort of re-entering the market with kind of playing on the fringes, doing some transactional business, selling parts to some airlines. But doing a major program with an airline maintenance was sort of the holy grail. Really tough, you know, I'm not going to even sugarcoat it for you. And I think you've got, for us, we certainly did the delegation trips. But working with the Trade Office's Advocacy Center, the U.S. Department of Commerce, their Advocacy Center, you know, we typically think of the Advocacy Center for the big companies, the Boeings, the huge conglomerate corporations. But actually, the Advocacy Center, I think, is really best suited, or who could benefit best from that, are the mid-sized to small companies. The Advocacy Center has less of a connection to the small businesses that would want to do business in Africa. So it's a disconnect between the two. But what they do is that you, one, have to be the only U.S. company going after a piece of business in that country. And it's not just for Africa, it's any country. But in Africa, it's particularly helpful. And then they help knit together an entire advocacy campaign to help you compete to win business. The challenge for us in Africa is that France and Germany have such a toehold in China on Africa. France having colonized Africa in the past, and China is sort of pseudo-colonizing now. So it's tough for U.S. companies because they don't really know the U.S., and the U.S. isn't there. AAR is serving on President Obama's Advisory Council to Doing Business in Africa initiative to encourage more businesses to do business in Africa. I think countries in Africa certainly want U.S. to be more engaged and doing more business, so their only options aren't Europe and Asia. So that, I think, is a combination of, for us, it was delegation trips, of course, but that advocacy center was important, and then putting down a stake in the ground in the continent and in the country. I, for a year and a half, traveled every month to South Africa for a year and a half. I mean, it just takes that kind of presence. And then on top of that, I've recently hired someone to be on the ground who is in country and from the country. So it's a combination of using every lever that commerce and trade office and out hustling your competition and having a presence in the country.
Thank you. Wow.
Well, piggybacking off what Cheryle just said, Obama identifying Sub-Saharan Africa being a huge market of interest with American export, that's something that's been pretty obvious. And with Darley, we've been exporting since 1940, so the whole export is very much ingrained in our blood. And you know, with going into Africa, we've had some trial and error. We've worked with different agents and different companies in different capacities. But with our products, in particular Africa, they have some of the largest needs for some of our products with fire and life safety and water purification. So because the needs there, that's really what's driven the interest from our products to export our products. And with water purification, there's great need here with domestic military market. But as you look at Africa, with the growing mega cities and the major urbanization, there's this huge logistical challenges to be able to provide water on a daily basis, but also in emergency settings. And looking at these major high rises that are going up and then figuring out how we can provide fire suppression in these buildings. That's a big deal. That's not just selling a product there, but figuring out the system of how these people are going to use these products and the whole system of operations. So there's a lot of challenges that go with selling high-end manufactured products, but that's something we've worked with XM, we've worked with the SBA, we've worked with a lot of different the state-endorsed entities that allow us to facilitate this business in Africa. It's been great for us, but I think we've all up here can agree it is definitely a little bit of trial and error, but hopefully you learn from your experiences, and I think there's a lot of positive outlook with the future of business in Africa for Darley & Company.
Well, and it sounds like at least part of your success is due to the fact that you've been there for so long.
Yep.
The persistence of being on the ground, as Cheryle was saying, you got to be there.
Yeah, you got to really got to feel and experience the problem. And I think you can market, you can put out a piece of literature, and that's one thing, but unless you really go there and experience the true problem, and I myself have helped with a couple different water installations, and really actually seeing the true need and actually seeing the need for just clean water on a daily basis, to me was something that really opened my eyes to stay committed to figuring out how do we connect the dots and actually implement these systems.
Maybe not the right question for everybody, but how did you figure out who you wanted the Commerce Gold Key program to identify for you? In other words, when you do a gold key, you got to spend some time sort of...
There's a form you fill out.
Yeah, no, I understand that, but it can go a couple of different ways.
Yeah. You know? Well, I mean, for us, I think on the form they ask for what types of companies you think might be of interest to you. So we'll say these are the industries, these types of companies might be of interest to us. But I think for us, the most important thing that happened, and probably more so in Ethiopia than in Ghana on that first trip, was there was a gentleman in the U.S. Embassy, an Ethiopian gentleman who did an excellent job. Really, I don't know whether he went on the internet, studied all the different companies coming, and came up with a group of companies that we should meet. But then I think what also helped was they did a pretty good marketing or advertising campaign and had a reception at the U.S. Embassy. Mm. And a lot of other companies came there that weren't even invited to the B2B discussion. And one of the companies I'm getting ready to sign an MOU with probably in the next few months was somebody I met at the reception. And at the reception, what they did was the eight or so companies that were there each had a desk. And we put out brochures and information on what we did. And people were mingling around, having drinks, eating, and to stand and talk to you. Because the B2Bs were limited. So, you know, and some of them were not very good fits. Mm-hmm. You know, go there, you start talking to the guy, and you're thinking, oof, this guy, we have nothing in common. Let's try and get him out of here. He wants to leave. You want him to leave. You know, you could tell very quickly. You could tell very quickly, this is not going anywhere. So the reception was good because it gave everybody a little more time to talk, and you didn't feel constrained to spend 30 minutes with that guy. If he came and he said, what do you do? And he said, we do this, 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 and it didn't fit. You know what? He had his glass of wine, he moved on to the next guy. So for us, it really helped. And that's how we met this company, and you know, we've gone from there.
Wonderful, Sophia.
Yes, as I said earlier, the U.S. Department of Commerce, they put us in touch with their colleagues in the U.S. Embassy in the targeted country. Those companies they present to us, they are pre-screened. They know, however, the officials who are working in the U.S. embassies, they have deep knowledge about the market conditions. They know how to present to us, not a waste of the time. So it's amazingly how they are high qualified, potential customers or partners for us. Again, as I said, all of them, they are qualified. They are already in the business, most of them more than 20 years, 30 years. They are knowledgeable about their market. So that's how we identify the potential partners for us.
Yeah. Cheryle, I imagine you're more constrained because of the way the industry works.
Well, yes and no. I mean, we know who our big companies, the airlines that we need to work with and want to go after. And you know, we rely heavily on the Commerce Office and the ambassadors and to make and facilitate those meetings. The challenge is around your local partners, because there just isn't doing business in Africa without having, in most cases, a local partner. So that then becomes the challenge. How do you find the right local partner? I mean, here in the U.S., with just amongst ourselves, it's tricky and can be dicey. Trying to do that, you know, in countries where you don't have a network is a particular challenge. And it's trial and error. And that's where you really have to then tap a few more resources. You have to go into the private sector. So we've talked a lot about today about government, U.S. government being a resource to connect you to opportunities and to vet. And there's also a need for, I've noticed, on the commercial side and the private sector side, a resource to help you vet and connect to people and opportunities in Africa. So that's whether that's in country or it's, you know, the reps. There are a couple different ways to come about this. We have foreign reps. So those whose business it is, they command an expertise in a particular country. And they're your external kind of salesperson. They facilitate meetings and try and facilitate a deal happening. So there's these kind of foreign reps. And then there are organizations and companies who have compilation of former ambassadors who have lived in country, or business leaders who have led business units for companies in country. And so their network of being on the ground and in country is really helpful. Of course, that costs money. So, but this is how we find our local partners, through a combination of in-country, private sector, commercial networks and experience, as well as U.S. government. U.S. government is far more efficient and a lot less costly. Sometimes you need both to get to the right answer. I hope that was helpful.
Yeah, and if I can just add on the how do you vet your potential partners? The Commerce Department actually has a vetting service.
Yeah.
The lady who runs it started here in Chicago and built this company really from the ground up. She started with the contract for vetting companies in China through the Commerce Department, and now she's worldwide. You can reach her at glo-bis.com, and she does terrific work.
And if you work with the U.S. embassies or commercial officers in country, they charge a nominal fee.
Yeah.
To vet local partners.
And she's the one who actually does the vetting.
She does the actual vetting. But so I generally work with the embassies.
But you can go direct to her as well, and she's terrific. She'll be here in July or August. We'll probably do a program with her. But glo-bis.com is her website. Her fees are reasonable. She just did some work for a good friend of mine, and they were very, very happy with it. And he still has both arms and both legs. It didn't cost him. Yeah, thank you. Kevin, what's been your experience?
On the fire side, a lot of times these fire departments are nationalized, so yep. We're actually working directly with the government in some capacity. So when you find the right people, it's pretty transparent, but sometimes we still need to work with an agent in some form to actually find that correct opportunity and find the right person in the fire department, but that's within the government. So as Cheryle was saying, you know, really it's I think the most important thing is a level of trust amongst the agent, and you can only do that through a vetting process. And if we've learned anything, is use the resources that the state and the government provides, because most of the time they're free and they provide great value, and usually it allows you to CYA and not have to worry about getting into some big problem down the road. Whereas on the water side, it's a little bit more different on these some of these water projects, because water is a very localized, emotional issue. And a lot of times we have to work with local Rotary clubs or different NGOs that truly understand the water politics and allow us to sort of, you know, find out the true need, figuring out the logistics within the community and implementing a system that's not just going to be installed and break in 2 years, but something that hopefully can be sustainable over the course of years. So combination, I'd say, of trust, use the state, and you know, take it one step at a time.
Yeah, good advice. Are there any unusual challenges in Africa? I mean, most of you do business globally, so, you know, looking at Africa, are there anything particularly unusual or that stands out in Africa compared with other global markets? And that can be, you know, financing, risk management, shipping, transportation, dispute resolution, whatever. Anything come to mind, Eugene, or anybody want to jump in?
I mean, I would say there's a huge market opportunity to doing business in Africa. Everybody says, oh yeah, that's a big opportunity. But unlike other continents, my view anyway, I think it takes a lot longer to take an opportunity and actually develop it. There is a need. I mean, for example, we are trying to sell equipment we build for, we fabricate equipment that can be used to run machines and run systems, et cetera, et cetera. We are trying to work with a partner that already has a fabrication facility in Ethiopia to be able to sell them certified pressure vessels and tanks, which nobody makes in Ethiopia because nobody's certified. So you would think, oh, this is a big opportunity. We should be able to run in tomorrow and get this going. They've been exporting these tanks from Europe and Middle East and other parts of the world for years. It's not that easy to all of a sudden, one, just fly right in and boom, these things happen. The man's in a hurry, wants us to get going, but it's taken us 3 years to get to this point where we're actually going to do something. So the opportunities are there, but it takes a while. Even if you find a good partner with the resources, it still takes a long time to get it started. Now, if you're doing distribution or something else, it might be a lot quicker. But anything where there's an infrastructure type, capital intensive type work involved, and some places it's not easy to even get money in or out. So you have to think about, well, you know, how are we going to invest? How are we going to do this? And if we actually do make a profit, how do I get my money out of the country to do whatever I want to do? And sometimes those discussions end up being longer to resolve. I mean, we do work in China. They'll pay in dollars, no big deal. You go to some other places, you can't get any currency. So those are some challenges I've found.
Okay. Just sort of an FYI for everybody, there are lots of non-bank foreign exchange operations in the Chicago area. I can think of five of them offhand, and they're all competing for exactly this kind of business. The problem is, how do I get my money out of Ethiopia? You can go, I'm sure Mary can get you a list, I can get you a list. And that's what they do. They figure out how to make it work for you. Sophia, I think you were...
It is challenging to compete with the other products coming from other countries, from China. Like, for example, the tires where I'm promoting. It is difficult to compete with Sri Lanka, India, China tires in Africa. But it's still the only option target the countries we're having free trade agreements. Unfortunately, we have only Morocco in Africa. We're having free trade agreements. I hope in the near future that America gets more free trade agreements with more countries in Africa. I think for my exports to Morocco as a gate of Africa, I do a lot of export to Morocco. From Morocco, they the export to other African countries, as Mr. Benedri said, of the other trade agreements Morocco has with other African countries. Besides this, it is important to like shipping company. We have a great shipping company taking care of the most difficult headaches we can face. Financial, fortunately, we secure with the help of U.S. Department of Commerce loan to secure the export operations. But again, I will come back again to the first one, which to talk to do some effort to open more markets through the free trade agreements with the African countries.
Okay. Cheryle?
You know, Richard, I was thinking about this for the last couple of days, like how honest was I going to be when I got here about this particular question? Well, let me put it in diplomatic terms. Ease of doing business. What is trying to assess what the level and factor of the ease of doing business. So let me translate that. corruption is, you know, a reality, and how that's probably one of the biggest challenges is, you know, understanding that, and it's more pervasive in certain industries over other industries. And I think that really what's the driver, some of the driver of corruption is just kind of the political risks. You know, it's the political environments are constantly changing and in these countries. So this lack of stability politically is probably the biggest challenge. And things like corruption is a offshoot of that. So, you know, when we talk about, you know, looking at going into emerging markets like most of Africa is, there are certain risks. They do assessments of the risks. They talk about financial risks. They talk about commercial risks. They talk about, you know, the customs and all this. Very little discussion, open discussions ever had about political risks and the assessment of that, because that should factor into your business strategy. Essentially, it doesn't mean that you shouldn't do business there. You just need to be very informed and have a process of a strategy around how do I get informed about this, because this will impact the arc of which, you know, you're able to do business. That arc is long. This is Africa is a marathon. It is not a sprint. It is not a 5K. It is not a 10K, okay? It is a marathon. And you have to go in with that understanding, that mentality, that I'm not here to be transactional right out of the gate. I'm here to build an infrastructure of relationships and a wealth of knowledge that will help me to sustain me to do business. I think once you crack the code, the Africa code, that's, you know, it's very, very, we're still in the process of cracking the code. So yes, we do business in Kenya.
Sure.
It's significant business in Kenya. Program, that's our first major program with Kenya. Some countries are easier than others. I think Rwanda is, I was just on a delegation trip with Secretary Pritzker. We were in Lagos and Abuja and Kigali, Rwanda. Rwanda is beautiful, very progressive, their ease of business is top notch. So, so smaller countries like that are growing rapidly should be looked at. But yes, biggest challenge is the political risks assessments, and unfortunately, corruption is a byproduct of it. You gotta find a strategy, develop a strategy of how do I constantly, you're in school, you're going off to school, to college, and you gotta get educated.
Right.
How do I get my tools to educate myself? And just be persistent and patient. Those two things, they're critical.
One way you can do that, every year the World Bank publishes a thing called its Ease of Doing Business Index. Mm-hmm. It's a really handy way to evaluate countries. And it doesn't explicitly, I don't think it explicitly has a political box on there, but it's got economic and all kinds of indicators. It's a great benchmark.
It's got corruption in it.
It does.
It's got corruption in it.
Under Transparency.
Oh, Transparency International, yeah. And then there's another group called Transparency International.
And they have their own.
That has their own index. But again, it's published every year. It's easy to find on the web. You can get historical data so you can see if it's looking more or less corrupt this year than it was last year. Well, I mean, I say that kind of tongue in cheek, but not to be laughed at. And then for those of you who are affiliated with publicly held corporations or not, the U.S. has a thing called the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. And oh my, you don't want to run afoul of that because the penalties are steep and they're against the company and you, the person. So on that cheery note, yeah, please.
I'd like to make a point about ease of doing business. I mean, you hit on a very good point. But this is also a bit of a contradiction, which every time I go on the continent, you can go to Ghana and get a visa at the airport before you get through customs. I mean, they're trying to make it easy to come in and do business. You can get to Ethiopia and you can pay right there and get a visa to come in. So these countries have figured it out. We want to get business in here, we'll do whatever it is to make it easy for you to come in. So on one hand, getting in is not that difficult in most of these places, but it doesn't mean the rest of the process is going to go any faster. If you go to, I was in Tanzania last year, they're doing everything you can imagine to make foreign investment come into the country. But does it mean it's going to work? I mean, you can go there and I think in a few hours you can even register a new business. It's that easy. Don't get fooled by thinking you were able to register your company in 2 days. All of a sudden, you can pick up the phone, go to this department, and stuff will happen. No, that's the easy stuff.
Mm-hmm. Kevin?
Yeah, from a product perspective, when we're selling trucks, you know, when we did the 32 trucks to Lagos, we had to really make sure that we were ensuring what fuel they were using, because there's different types of fuels throughout the world and that affects which engine we're sourcing. And we had a really nasty case in Saudi Arabia where we sold the wrong truck for the wrong fuel source, and it was just an ongoing headache lawsuit. And that was something we learned from. For now, we really have to do an intense vetting process, because even across Africa, the fuel sources are extremely variable. And that really affects the type of engines we have to use within the trucks that we sell. And then within that, one of the issues we face from a product perspective is there's still a lot of countries that use European standards as opposed to American standards. Still kind of this modern day effect of post-colonialism where sometimes they're really stuck to a European standard, but sometimes, like in Nigeria, eventually the equipment is just so old that they just scrapped it and started over with the American truck. So that's a challenge that we face, as well as just tropicalizing trucks and equipment. That's something that's really important. And you know, I think some of the other, I guess, things, some things we can't control, where we have some trucks in Ghana where they're currently now just sitting there not doing anything because they actually don't even have the money to pay for the fuel. So there's something where it's more than just selling and getting the trucks there through, you know, similar. We do work with Exxon. We've got a lot of trucks there, but it's more than just the truck, but it's the training, it's the maintenance, the ongoing usage that a lot of times gets overlooked. And that's something that why different financing options for more than just the equipment itself is so important, because it's a whole realm of system deployment, logistics that you know, we're facing today. So that's something that we can learn from, something that we know we can work with the state better, and you know, hopefully working more with Exim and different government entities, we'll be able to better support the whole cradle to grave, full life cycle emergency equipment.
Really important. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I just. I want to make a plea for another thing. You know, we talk about the government agencies and what they can provide. It's really, really key. But my experience has been that some of the best sources for talking about doing business are people who are doing business. And so the American Chambers of Commerce, for example, in every one of the countries, that should be one of your first stops when you go, whether you're going on a delegation or whatever. Stop in and see the U.S. Chamber of Commerce that's there, you know, called AmCham, they're called business councils or whatever. But these are the people every day who have to worry about payment issues. They have to worry about reconciling standards issues. They're the ones that have to figure out how to get their money out of the country. And they're a very, very good source. And they will be actually more frank with you than the government people will, because the U.S. government people are there to help American companies. So they'll give you a wink and a nod sometimes when it's an issue that you really sink your business. And also, when, if you're competing with other American companies, it's very difficult because they can't recommend you. If it's two or more American companies, they can only say, here's a list of American companies who qualify. They won't point out your company and say it's the best one, even if it is. So you want to make sure is to get information from the people who are actually on the ground doing the business, because they can be really, really helpful, just as these people have been very helpful to you. But in-country is even more helpful.
Thank you. Excellent advice. Yeah.
Can I just add on the issue of ease of doing business and, you know, the corruption issue? And I want to couch the whole corruption issue as kind of, like I said, it's a more outcome of political, you know, issues and cultural issues. So, but the other thing that factors into corruption issues are the fact that, you know, companies in Europe and Asia are not bound by FCP, Foreign Corruption Practice Act. So things that we call corruption is just business over there. So that's another reality that you're up against, is it does not make for a level playing field. However, working with the resources that the government has and their network, I think oftentimes that which will help when you're up against, you know, what other companies, European and Asian companies are bringing to the table to entice business in Africa. What you can do is come to the table with financing. To your point is, you're selling trucks and equipment, but then you know it's going to be a fuel issue down the road. So if you problem solve for the country or for the opportunity or the business, the entity in Africa, the better. And if you come to the table with your financing in place, and that's what I believe OPIC and Ex-Im Bank and the National Trade Office will help you do, is to put together a financing, so when you do go to compete or you do go to pitch for business, you can, it's like when you buy a home. You know, when you buy a home and say, I got all cash, okay, end of discussion. Okay, that house is yours. So when you go to the table and you're competing on a bid or doing business and you have, my financing is done, also you're gonna need XYZ, I don't sell it, but in order to, you know, win or to really leverage this opportunity, you bring other resources, you problem solve for them, and you bring those resources to the table. That helps tremendously.
I think one other thing too, that I think is useful, we are a small business, so having a local partner to help you do business is critical. I mean, your company is a lot larger. You can invest lots of money to develop the type of infrastructure you need to do business in whatever country it is. But if you're not that big, my personal view is you don't go and do business anywhere outside the U.S. without having somebody in that country as your partner. And the person who's your partner should have skin in the game. If they don't have skin in the game, you're wasting your time. For example, the company we want to partner with to do fabrications in Ethiopia, the man's been in business 30, 40 years. He has a facility. He's renowned. People know who he is. What he lacks is the additional technical expertise and the engineering know-how to make certain products. But they know who he is. And companies come from overseas and use him. So when we go in, we are providing him with the little bit he needs, but he's also putting his facility, his reputation, and all those things at risk every time he works with us. So he becomes the front of our business in dealing with the local government, those types of people. We price, we do what we have to do to get our margin, and we work with that person. Now, if you go in and, you know, it's like going somewhere where they can look at you and they can tell in 2 seconds, he's not from here. I mean, you're done. I mean, they can tell you're not from here, and everything after that gets marked up. A price of coffee costs 5 times what it should because you think, oh, Starbucks, eh, it's about $5 for a latte. So that 20-cent cup of coffee just costs you $5, and you think it's a fair price just because they know you're not from there. So it happened to us in Ethiopia, so I know. It was a 12-year-old kid. It was a 12-year-old kid who's hustled us. We thought it was a fair deal, you know. So to get around some of the corruption issues and all that, try and have somebody who's reputable, is from that place, lives in there, has some skin in the game, so you are protected from...
It's not just a small business. I mean, it is big and small. I mean, it's every... If you're just not from that country, you need a local partner, period.
And the best advice I ever heard was from an American attorney who was located in Vietnam right after the embargo was lifted. We were able to get in there. And she was talking about doing business in Vietnam, which was incredibly corrupt at the time. I mean, just everybody had their hand out. And I will never forget her words. She said, never, never, never give a bribe to anyone. Because in a country like Vietnam, if you give it to one person, everybody you meet will have their hand out. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are no secrets in these countries. And I think the same thing applies here. Don't start and you won't have a problem. And on the upside of this, a lot of the Western countries who are members of the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, and these are the sort of the most developed countries in the world, have signed a pledge and maybe done a little more moving toward a code of ethics that's very similar to our Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. So that just leaves the Chinese going around in Africa bribing everybody. But it's better than, you know, having too many. Now, there's some questions in the back. Ma'am?
Mine is not a question, it's just to add to some of the comments that I've heard. We're talking about entrepreneurship. What's the definition of that? Ability to take risk. So there is risk involved in business any and everywhere. And we do also know about neocolonialism. Most of the countries of Africa, they suffer colonization. And so it's not written in books, but if you was an Anglophone country or Francophone, you'd have that affinity first. It's more like sell your raw materials to me first before you talk about somebody else. And somebody had talked about the issue of value added, which is a major concern. So hearing this, we also know about everybody wants to go to do business in Africa. Of course, it's the richest continent in the world with all of this. It has a lot to play, and it's a lot of money to be made. And so some people are going to do the best we can to put those other people away. There are risks involved everywhere, and I'm not saying we should trivialize any of this. But going with this knowledge, we should also know, and I've also heard why many American companies are not there, and why, you know, Chinese are like real in, because they study and understand what they need to do. And we sort of just focus more on the risk and being afraid and all that. I believe what we need to do is first understand the business environment. I've heard the comments, but you must have intercultural training before you even go to any of these countries. You need to study and understand. We have organizations here. If you want to talk to me about that, I can assist you, all right?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's kind of, that's kind of what our panelists have been saying. You've got to understand the market.
Right, but you need to have that training on a one-on-one and understand more even before you have the foreign partner or local partner. So I don't want us to sit here and be afraid and everybody is going there and doing business and then we go, we don't find many American businesses because we're
I don't think anybody's
people.
Saying...
Thank you.
I don't think anybody's saying go there and be afraid. I think what we're hearing is go there with a strategic plan in mind. Do some homework and have a strategy going in. That's why you've got these four really expert people here.
But I would agree with you that this cultural sensitivity is a very real issue. Even when it comes to tackling issues of corruption, what we say corruption is really maybe interpreted culturally differently in that country. And so when you have a different reaction, you know where your line is and you're not gonna cross your line, but you're not going to recoil and think that, oh, this is evil or people are evil. It's just a cultural difference. So in any case, I get what you said, and I think that's a valid point.
You know, at that point, there was a CEO from one of the global companies that spoke last year here in Chicago at an event downtown. Mm-hmm. And the issue of corruption came up. And the first thing he said was, how many governors in the state of Illinois have gone to jail? I mean, that was his opening remark. You know, and everybody kind of chuckled because we Democrats, they all go at some point in time. So the point he was trying to make is we don't view that, you know, some guys sitting in some countries looking at America and they don't see us as pristine. But we tend to view what they do, or they look at our lobbyists who go up to D.C. and cutting, you know. Right. So the issue of corruption is how you define
how
it
you
from
define
their perspective. You know, we don't think a lobbyist is influencing anything. So you have to be culturally sensitive to some of those things.
Sensitive.
And if you have a policy whereby you're not going to say, you know, here's a bribe to do, there are ways to get around some of those things. And you have to understand what those ways are in those different environments. Or you might insult somebody. Because
Sophia, you had something to say.
I think my opinion and through my experience, if you have a good product, which sells good here in America, it can sell overseas. If you have good products, competitive prices, no corruption, no any other things will stop. Nothing. Yeah. With the time people liberalize, you have good product, competitive prices. That's what they are looking for. Even the people they are into corruption, what they are asking for, right, or whatever, the end of it, they will look for you. You have a competitive price. They will do business with you. So the point here, just believe in, be confident, believe what you in your products, be persistent, as you say, be patient. Yep. You get there. It takes some time. For me, it took 10 years to get at this level. With the time, it will come back to you. It will be rewarding. Your effort will be rewarding, and you will get a market. You will share on the market where you are targeting.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I would like to make one comment. And the second, it would be a question. A comment I want to make is related to the role of Africa in diaspora. I believe the African diaspora, or most of who are here, you know you have acquired capacity to help American businesses to do business in the Africa. I think you guys should tap into the diaspora here in the US, that will be really helping you guys to do business in Africa. I want just to give you a typical example, what took place for American company. One of business owner here in the US flew to Lagos, Nigeria. He spent almost 1 week trying to figure out how to do business in Nigeria. It was tough for him. He remembered he had a friend in New Jersey. He called him, I'm trying to close a deal here. I can't close a deal here. What to do? Give me a tip. He had to call back from Nigeria to here in the US. The guy said, okay, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna fly you from Lagos to Abuja. You're gonna close your business in Abuja. Actually, he connected a guy who has a private jet. The guy who has a private jet flew him in his private jet to Abuja. And then the guy was here, we met through one of conferences like this. He was telling me this story. He said, most of our US companies just go to Africa and ignore us here living in the US. Actually, we are the one having understanding of our African market. They should reach out to us so we can help them. Actually, he closed the business deal. Big deal, maybe was around $100 million. The deal was closed. That's one of the comments I want to say.
If I can just comment on your comment, it is not just Africa.
Yeah, exactly.
It is not just Africa. American companies are famous for what Barry Goldwater used to call the ready, fire, aim principle.
Exactly.
Worldwide, so it's not just Africa.
In this case, I was mentioning Africa.
Now your question
is to panelists. Mm-hmm. How do you address issue of capacity building? Local capacity building. Because most of you guys, business people, you want to go in Africa, you make money, you repatriate your money back in the US, that's it, you're done. So how do you address this question? How do you build your capacity?
Well, that's a great question, and that's what AAR does in the U.S. and wherever we do business with, particularly outside the U.S. We don't go into any markets without a local partner and a local plan for capacity building. So we would never go into any country, particularly including Africa, saying we're going to set up an MRO shop, we're going to fly our people in, we're going to provide that. That's a recipe for disaster. So that's kind of, for us, basic. With South Africa, we submitted an entire plan around how do we build the capacity of South African businesses, the skill sets of South Africans, particularly South Africans who have been disenfranchised. How do we, support the government? So there's a whole plan, and South Africa is very sophisticated about that, requiring that plan. But even with us, and our business is labor intensive, so it really hinges on having a skilled workforce. Okay. So we have to invest locally, whether that's locally in Rockford, Illinois, or locally in Lagos or Abuja. Wherever we're standing up a facility, an MRO facility, we need to be able to have a skilled labor force, or we don't have the capacity ourselves to grow. So it starts with investing locally where you are. To your point of leveraging expatriates that are based here in the U.S. to help in Africa as well as other countries, but in particularly Africa, because I think for U.S., Africa is very exotic and different. So, Europe, okay, we got that. Asia is familiar. Europe is familiar. Africa is different. I'm tapping Dr. Iwa, tapping those that are here in this country that are connecting me to people. You have to start in your own backyard, before you go leaping across the pond to make new friends. Look in your own backyard for friends right next to you. So yes, capacity building locally, investing in local communities is key to us being able to deliver a service and grow ourselves. And we do it through skilled labor force and small businesses and education, working with the local governments and the country governments on their curriculum.
Kevin, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, I look at there as being two really different types of capacity. One, with our own capacity, similar to what Cheryl was saying, that we manufacture high-end products, there's high-end labor that's required, and it really requires, one, improving and maintaining our supply chain process, but also using and leveraging pre-financing options, which we've now become more accustomed to. But then on the other side, capacity in the country, to where the biggest thing is really education, where it's truly understanding the whole scope of what you're getting, what you're doing, why you're using it, how you're using it, the who, what, when, where, why. That, to me, that capacity of the implementation is the most important part. We can do what we can build here and do, and it's good to establish some small wins here domestically, and we've been in business for a while, but really it's these new countries. They all have their own cultural sensitivity. They all have their own historical background, and the education of how we're working and then tweaking it to what makes sense for them, to me, is the modern day most important part of doing business in Africa.
I'd like to add to that, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
To your point, a lot of those countries, as they try to promote more growth, have made it a requirement that this local country content in whatever comes to the country. And so for example, if you're trying to sell certain types of equipment into Ghana's oil and gas industry, it starts off with maybe 10% has to be local, goes up to 15, 20, et cetera, et cetera. So they give you a little bit of time to get to a certain level. And depending on the product you're selling into those countries, it makes absolutely no sense to try and do it all in the U.S. and ship.
Yeah.
It doesn't. The type of products you make where there are repairs that have to be done, there's an aftermarket service business, you better have some local folks or else somebody's going to undercut you sooner or later because they can do it cheaper, they train folks. So what we are trying to do is when we partner, in the beginning, let's say we are building a table. Let's say, you know, we go to Ghana and we say, nobody here can build a table. Fine. Maybe what we do is we make the tabletop, we make all the legs, we make all the pieces, we would ship it over there and have somebody locally assemble it and take it to the job site. They get their 10% local content in there, and that's how you start. Maybe the next time, somebody in Ghana makes the wheels, or wherever, you slowly train them, and you develop that local capacity. But you'd be foolish to try and do it all here and always ship down. If you go to Ethiopia, you find a lot of Chinese folks building the roads, right? You can only do that for so long before somebody gets resentful because there are local people sitting right there out of work.
Well, for those who missed yesterday's Chicago Tribune, someone may have noticed that the CTA just let a $1.3 billion contract for new railway cars for the Chicago Transit Authority. The Chinese company that won the contract is actually going to put a factory in Chicago and do it there because there was a local content rule to that.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm starting to feel like an undeveloped country.
Yes, I have a comment and a question. But before I pass my comment, let me first of all congratulate these four folks who have done business successfully in Africa, because you became a case study. We said today, Africa matters. Africa is the future. And Africa is a continent of possibilities, not a problem. Vision is greater than ambition. And without vision, people perish.
That's right.
Without people, vision perish.
Right.
Many of you who have gone to Africa, you act like fate. See, faith is a lifestyle, not a formula. Many people defy that. I don't want to go to Africa at all, even if they are distributing money there. That's their belief. This has taken people like me decades to convince people that trust. If you don't trust yourself, you can't trust anybody.
Right.
There are issues I will bring into vibes here. Issue of cultural values. That is what we call respect. When you get to Africa, is attitude determines altitude. Whatever you are doing, they want to embrace you. They want to treat you like kings. It depends on the way you present yourself.
Right.
That works very well. Then secondly.
That's great advice, but we're running out of time. Mm-hmm. And that's a cultural value here.
Yeah. Then secondly, for most of the people that make money in Africa, invest in corporate social responsibility. Do not just make money and take it away. Also contribute back to the community. That helps a lot. And that even promotes your business. Thank you.
Thank you. And please all thank you to our wonderful panelists. It was really enlightening. And I
thank you, Richard, for facilitating this wonderful panel. Thank you again. We are right on time, but I will invite Ms. Lauren Estelado of SBDC to just share with you a little bit information about an upcoming event that SBDC is hosting. And then I'll give my 2-minute wrap up. You will get out of here by 3, I promise you. So she'll go share with you an event in 2 weeks that will happen in 2 weeks. Which is fine.
Thank you guys for allowing me the opportunity to tell you a little bit about the SBDC. We have a specialist, Mary Ma, she spoke a little earlier, who works with the international trade side of things. The SBDC helps small businesses grow and thrive, and we can help you with strategic planning and all sorts of different benchmarking reports that you may not be able to access yourself. So if you're interested in obtaining those services, we can provide that as well as a piece to complement Mary's international trade specialty. We also have our Women's Heels of Business breakfast coming up at the end of the month. It's Tuesday, March 29th. I have a bunch of flyers here that I'm going to put out on the front table so you can grab them on your way out. And we encourage all women business owners or entrepreneurs to come attend and learn a little bit about best practices and challenges that successful women business owners have gone through. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Enjoy the rest of your afternoon.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, since I opened it, I'm going to have the privilege to close it. So thank you again for joining us for a wonderful program today. And again, I want to thank to all the speakers. Some of them have to leave early because a couple of them have to fly back to DC. So again, thanks to all the sponsors, you and also my wonderful team, Mary, Lauren, my office manager who's not here, and then the team outside, Dan and Maisha. The SBDC staff, very small staff, but mighty staff. So without them, this won't be possible. So I just want to remind you before you go, there's an evaluation form inside your folder. It's under the program. So we like to collect your feedback because we are going to offer this type of program every year, at least for the next 2 years. So please let us know what you think about, your opinion about the format, the length, the food, and so we will definitely learn from it and try to improve. Next year, we hope to see some of you again. We haven't decided which region we'll focus on next year. Very likely will be Middle East or Southeast Asia. So we have two more year, to go for this program. So you will hear from us. Of course, many of you hopefully will be in touch with our SBDC or ITC to seek out their service or any of those government agencies that you heard today. And of course, our business panelists I'm sure they're all eager to share their experience with you. Hopefully you learned some tricks to crack the African code today. So with that, please don't forget your evaluation form. If you didn't sign on that group photo release, please add your name to it. Because if we don't have your signature, we can't run any photo with you in it. So please give our speakers a final round of applause and enjoy the rest of your afternoon.
Thank you so much. Enjoyed it.
Thank you, Richard.
Thank you. Enjoyed it so much.
Thank you.
Good. How are you?